Isn't this week a treat? We just wanted to come and put ourselves back under the tap, as it were, for a few days. So to be able to speak as well is a privilege. If we're going to live naturally supernatural lives, we need an ongoing experience of God's Word and an ongoing experience of God's Spirit. We need Scripture, and we need the presence and power of God. And that's what I've been asked to talk about. Now, when we arrived at our hosts on Wednesday, we went up to our room, and there very helpfully was a wardrobe and lots of hangers, and we could hang up our shirts and jumpers so that we could get them easily. They'd stay nice for the week. And what I want to do is to offer you some hangers on which to put an understanding of the Word and the Spirit, so that they're accessible to you and you can wear them and live by them. And the first is like this, as at the beginning. It all begins on the day of Pentecost. And the way it begins is the way that it continues. Pentecost, hear me loud and clear. Pentecost was not a one-off event. Pentecost was a beginning. And as at the beginning, so now. So on the day of Pentecost, they were all gathered and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, just as Jesus promised. In the chapter before, he said, you know it, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you'll be my witnesses. The Word, it will happen. The reality, it came. And then Peter's got to explain what's going on with that great sermon that begins, "We're not drunk." And he says, this is that. We know this is the Holy Spirit because this was what was promised in the Scripture. This was what was promised by the prophet Joel. I'll pour out my Holy Spirit on all flesh. We know it's the Holy Spirit because of the Word. We trust the Word and we receive the power of the Spirit. And then Peter has spent 40 days in Bible class with Jesus. Jesus has been opening the Scriptures to the disciples, but it's only when the Spirit falls upon them again that that becomes their teaching. So having pointed them to Joel, he then preaches the gospel from Psalms three times. He says, David says, Psalm 16, Psalm 110, Psalm 132. He says, David's a prophet, and anointed by the Spirit, he has a new understanding of Scripture. He's seeing things that were really there. He's understanding them for the first time, and he's proclaiming them. And then he makes it clear that what they have seen and heard has been an action of Jesus. If you want theology for naturally supernatural, you'll find it in Peter's speech. Acts 2, 32. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we're witnesses, being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this which you see and hear. This is Jesus. He has sent the Spirit, not just upon those first disciples in the upper room. Because a few verses later, he says this, for the promise is for you, for your children, for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him. There's the theology for naturally supernatural. Jesus has poured out what you see and hear, and the promise is for you, for the next generation, for the people that are far off, for everyone. What was the word? You don't sound as though you believe it. Say it again. What was the word? The promise is for everyone whom the Lord calls. Pentecost was not a one-off. It was a beginning. And theologian I've been reading recently called Craig Keener, who's a spirit-filled New Testament scholar, says, we expect to share the kind of spiritual experiences and relationship with God we discover in Scripture. Jesus' resurrection declares that the Jesus we hear about in the Gospels is now the exalted Lord who sent his Spirit so that we may continue to experience his presence. And Jesus is still the exalted Lord, so according to his word, the outpouring of his Spirit is for all his people. And my hanger, as at the beginning, doesn't come from Acts 2, it comes from Acts 11. Where Peter has experienced the outpouring of the Spirit on Gentiles in Cornelius's house. He's gone back to tell the church back home what was going on. And he says, as I began to speak, I mean, don't you hate that as a preacher? Done all that preparation, I just got started and God stepped in. How like him. As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell on them just as on us at the beginning. And you know what he says next? And then I remembered the words of the Lord Jesus. You will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Do you see? Spirit word, spirit word, spirit word. As at the beginning, Pentecost, not just a one-off, a beginning in which we continue to participate. Then a second hanger. The Word and the Spirit have been called the two hands of God. God ministers double-handed. It was a guy called Irenaeus, one of the early saints, who said that. And when he said it, what he meant was, Jesus, the incarnate Word, is, as it were, one of the hands of God in reaching to the world, and the Holy Spirit is the other. And Jesus is indeed the Word, which makes the Scriptures the Word about the Word. And we honor those Scriptures because they're God's gift to us by the Spirit, and because, frankly, there is no other Jesus to get to know than the one you meet through this book. So yes, for Irenaeus, the Word and the Spirit are the incarnate Son, the Word become flesh, and the Holy Spirit poured out. But we need a two-handed ministry. We need the Word about the Word and the Holy Spirit. And the Spirit is described as the Spirit of Christ or the Spirit of Jesus. The Holy Spirit always points to Jesus. John 16, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will glorify me. He will take what is mine and declare it to you. The whole ministry of the Spirit is that you may understand more and more of Jesus and enter more deeply into relationship with him. But the Holy Spirit does that in two different ways. The Holy Spirit is both self-effacing and visible and tangible. Both self-effacing and visible and intangible. It's the work of the Holy Spirit to point away from the Holy Spirit and point to Jesus. There was a great theologian of renewal with the Lord now called Tom Smale, and he said this, the Holy Spirit stands on our side of the relationship with the Father and the Son and makes it possible for us to know and confess them. The Holy Spirit stands on our side of the relationship with the Father and the Son and makes it possible for us to know and confess them. So every time you have encountered Jesus in intimacy, every time you have prayed to the Father, every time you have exercised the privilege of access to the Father through his Son, you have had an experience of the self-effacing Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was there making it possible. The Holy Spirit was there enabling you to relate to Jesus. And the other self-effacing way in which the Holy Spirit works is moment by moment, incident by incident, day by day, working in you to grow the character of Jesus in you. We call it the fruit of the Spirit. Paul says in Galatians, walk by the Spirit and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. In some Bibles, that's a command, but it's not a command, it's a promise. It's not walk by the Spirit, don't gratify the desires of the flesh. It's walk by the Spirit, and in the Spirit's power you won't. And moment by moment, bit by bit, largely without you noticing, the love, joy, and peace that are the character of Jesus are formed in you by the self-effacing Spirit. So much of the work of the Holy Spirit is not literally in our face. It's beside us, coming alongside to help. So what then about tangible? What about manifestations of the Spirit? What about all this stuff that, if we're honest, lots of us came here for? To each, says Paul, is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Because the Holy Spirit is totally, utterly, 100% about Jesus. So the Holy Spirit will enable you to have intimacy with Jesus. The Holy Spirit will form in you the character of Jesus. But the Holy Spirit will also show you and exercise through you the ministry of Jesus. And that's what we've been talking about in all of our meetings. It's the ministry of Jesus continuing by the Spirit. So when tangible things happen, when visible things happen, when things that you can feel and see and experience happen to you and other people, it's extraordinary transforming encounters. The Holy Spirit is doing his job of pointing to Jesus. Is showing you and exercising through you the ministry of Jesus. Whether it's behind the scenes or whether it's manifest, the Spirit always points to Jesus as the way to the Father. And if you want to minister more deeply in the ministry of Jesus, then pay attention to that self-effacing work of the Spirit, who is working to make Jesus visible in your life and character, as well as Jesus visible through your prayers. I'm charismatically long in the tooth. I've been involved in this renewal thing for more than 50 years. I have been to an awful lot of meetings. I have done hands down for coffee so many times, it's no longer funny. I've seen lots and lots of people encounter the Holy Spirit in different ways. I've heard them call out Lord. I've heard them call out Jesus. I've heard them call out Abba. I've heard them call out Father. I don't think in 50 years I've seen an authentic encounter with the Spirit where the person calls out Spirit. The Holy Spirit points you to Jesus. And if that's one hand of God, then the other hand of God, the word about the word, the scriptures, are also all about Jesus. We know he said so. Luke 24, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. A few verses later, everything that's written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. That's the titles of the three parts of what we called the Old Testament, according to Jews at the time. In each section, he opened their minds to the things about himself and what was to be fulfilled. And the moment he'd opened their minds to the scriptures, he said, "Wait until you are clothed with power from on high." You need to see it, and you need to be empowered to live it and teach it. You need a proper understanding of the scriptures, and you need the power of God's Spirit. And when Jesus says that, I wonder if he had in mind one of the sadder incidents in his ministry, when he saw the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, it's in Matthew 22, and said, "You know neither the scriptures nor the power of God." But to his disciples, he opens the scriptures and says, "Wait for power from on high." We need a two-handed ministry. The ministry of Jesus is a ministry of word and of spirit. A third hanger, a simpler one. A dear friend, John Wimber, used to say, "This is the menu. This is the menu. The purpose of the menu is so that you have the meal." You need to know the book so that you can enter into what the book says. But there's one difference between this menu and the menu that we were given in an Indian restaurant up the road earlier this week. You need to eat all of it. You don't go to it just for your favorite dishes. You need to engage with and live out and learn from and be enlightened by everything that's in it. Theologian called Clark Pinnock puts it beautifully. He said, Scripture is a means of grace by which God's word continues to come to us. It's not a static collection of timeless oracles. It's the place to stand when you want to be in God's presence and learn of him. I love that. The place to stand when you want to be in God's presence and learn of him. Through the Bible, we orient ourselves to the objective revelation that's given. This is God's truth. Through the Spirit, we enter into it personally and dynamically. So there's your third hanger. The menu and the meal. But the whole menu is there to be consumed, not just the favorite dishes. Take me to an Indian restaurant and there's about, I'm a coward, I know what I like and I'm not sure of anything else, so I go for the bit I always go to. Engage yourself with the whole of God's word, not just your favorite bits. I'll give you a fourth picture, a fourth hanger. And that's of a marriage. When, as a minister of the Church of England, I marry someone, there's a wonderful moment when they're making their vows, and it's too late to go back now, where I say, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Those hands were celebrating their 40th anniversary. What God has joined together. If the Word and the Spirit are the two hands of God, they are hands that God has joined together permanently. They are inseparable. They are interconnected. The Holy Spirit inspired the Scriptures. That's why we can trust them and speaks to us through them. To fully understand Scripture and to enter into what it says then, you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. I mean, can you imagine what it might be like to have an extraordinary book that challenges you and you're getting your head around it, and then you get offered the personal presence of the author? That's who the Holy Spirit is. Obviously working through the human authors and enabling you to understand what the human authors meant and were saying. When we acknowledge the Bible, we're actually acknowledging the Holy Spirit who inspired it to begin with and who addresses us through its pages. And when we read the book tells us who the Holy Spirit is, what the Holy Spirit is like, and how we may discern the Holy Spirit's presence. I've got a favorite quote from a Pentecostal theologian. It goes like this. If it's not scriptural, then no matter how charismatic it is, it's not of the Holy Spirit. You can see it. Say that one with me. If it is not scriptural, then no matter how charismatic it is not of the Holy Spirit. Jackie and I next week will be at the funeral of a dear saint of God who was one of the original teachers of the Fountain Trust that got mentioned in a word of knowledge earlier. And David Smith has just gone home to Jesus and we will be there to celebrate him. I always knew I was loved and accepted by him on the staff of St. Mark's Gillingham because we'd be in the staff meeting studying the scriptures and I would say what I thought was a really wise and erudite point from the passage and he will say, that's the trouble with you blooming theologians. He had this great saying, all word and you dry up. Just lots more knowledge. All experiences of the Spirit, and you blow up. word and spirit together, and you grow up. So don't dry up, don't blow up. They're inseparably joined. God has joined them together. Grow up. And here's another hanger. Take me a little longer on this one. Word and spirit have a common purpose, a combined purpose. And the best way we can see that is, I invite you to put two passages side by side. Extracts from them are up there. Colossians 3, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teach and admonish one another in all wisdom and with gratitude in your hearts. Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to God. Whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Paul to the church at Colossae. Paul to the church at Ephesus. I'll take it from verse 15. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time because the days are evil. Don't be foolish. Understand what the will of the Lord is. Don't get drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and being subject to one another out of reverence for Christ. Did you notice the parallels? But one says the word of God dwell in you richly, and the other says be filled with the Spirit. Now, note again, both word and spirit are Christ-focused. The word is called the word of Christ, probably meaning the whole gospel message centered on Jesus and reasonably by us being applied to the scriptures. And it's the word of Christ, which is not a surname but a title, the one anointed by the Spirit to bring the kingdom. Let the word of the anointed one dwell in you. And the focus of the ministry of the Holy Spirit is upon Jesus. We've heard that. To be filled with the Spirit is to be drawn more deeply in the person and work of God's Son. When Paul writes to the Ephesians, he says, you know what happens when the Spirit falls? You make melody to the Lord. The response is worship to Jesus. And these two passages basically say this. Every aspect of church life is the fruit of this combined ministry, this shared focus ministry of God's word and God's spirit. Wisdom, he says, requires word and spirit. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise. Be filled with the Spirit. The Colossians, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. If you want to live a naturally supernatural everyday life, what you need is wisdom from God. And that comes through the ministry of God's word and the ministry of God's Spirit. Because wisdom in the Old Testament and in the New isn't theory, it's lived wisdom. It's wisdom that takes you to the streets. It's about lived truth. And in Ephesians it says you need to be filled with the Spirit. I've been reading a particular commentary on Ephesians, and the author says this: if believers were only filled with wisdom, the influence would be impersonal. However, the filling of the Spirit adds God's personal presence, influence, and enablement. It adds God's personal presence, influence, and enablement. You are taught how to live in the book and empowered to live the teaching of the book by the personal, empowering presence of God, who is the Holy Spirit. Understanding what the will of the Lord is requires being filled with the Spirit. So the daily life of disciples is the fruit of word and spirit. The ministry of teaching in the church has to be the word anointed by the Spirit. Clark Pinnock again, if it's true that the presence of the Spirit is essential to interpret Scripture, then it follows that practitioners must be believers filled with the Spirit. We need people called to be teachers of the church who are anointed and filled with the Spirit for that task. Effective teaching comes from the word anointed. But it's not just those with, if you like, a teaching role or training or a teaching office. It is that in Colossians 1, Paul says, we proclaim Christ, warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. If you are a teacher in the church, that's your task. Warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom to present everyone mature in Christ. For that you need a deep understanding of the word and the anointing of the Spirit. But Paul says, it's not just people like me who stand on platforms or give sermons who open the book in formal settings. He says to the Colossians, let the word of God dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. And that's exactly the same word he said he was called to do. Warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom. That was, if you like, the teaching pastor's calling. But he says the whole community is to be indwelt by the word of God and continually and richly teaching and encouraging one another from what you are learning from the Scriptures. Teaching is a mutual ministry, not just a focus ministry. And then notice this, these commands, let the word of God dwell in you richly and be filled with the Spirit. They're all plural. They're not just about individuals. They're about the spiritual culture of congregations as communities of believers. They require that one another ministry, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing songs to one another, to encourage one another to praise the Lord. If you truly want a culture in which word and spirit fulfill their callings in God's economy, you need relationships as well. You need a quality of life in which that which we receive by the word and the spirit continually and generously we give to one another. It's a challenge to our individualism. It's about the shared life of a congregation. It isn't just about the combined experiences of individual Christians. It's a culture which says, Lord, we're attentive to your word and we share what we receive. Lord, we're open to your spirit. We respond always to what you do. It's a shared culture. It's plural. And the ministries of word and spirit overflowing corporate worship. Colossians, with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Ephesians, sing, guess what, psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord with all your heart. Word and spirit overflow in worship, and they overflow in daily lives and relationships, which are themselves offerings of worship to God. We had a great oboe player who was our primary music and worship leader in our years in York. And he had this little saying, as much as you worship God from Monday to Saturday is as much as you worship God. Our lives are to be acts of worship which give integrity to our songs. So Colossians, whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. That's a consequence of letting the word of God dwell in you richly. Ephesians, giving thanks to God the Father at all times for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, being subject to one another out of reverence for Christ. That's the consequence of being filled with the Spirit. We minister to one another with the word of Christ and the gifts of the Spirit. The Word and the Spirit combine to create a shared life of mutual love between Christians and results in thanks and praise to God. And congregational life like that needs continual renewal, ongoing openness to God's Word, ongoing openness to God's Spirit. There's a common purpose of Word and Spirit which makes congregations flourish. But then comes the scary bit, my next hanger. Same passage. Word and Spirit combine stability and unpredictability. Stability and unpredictability. Now, let me say something straight away. Unpredictable is not the same as untrustworthy. God is always faithful to His Word. His Spirit is the Spirit of Christ. The Holy Spirit has the character of Jesus. You can trust God's Word and you can trust God's Spirit utterly. And in that trust, you may have stability. Paul says, let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly. And what it means is, let the Word of Christ make its permanent home in you. And the you is plural. A rabbi said, he who dwells in the house is master of the house, not just a passing guest. You daren't let the Word of God to be a passing guest in your life or your family or your church. Allow the Word of God to take up permanent residence as the owner of the house. But then there's unpredictability. Note that God's Word will continually surprise you and catch you out. How many times have you said, I had never seen that before? How many times have you been in some situation which you really, really would not like to be in, but only through being there do you see something in God's Word that you had not seen before? It was always there, but you hadn't seen it. And if we are to minister God's Word to one another richly, that means, amongst other things, we're sharing our latest surprises as well as our deep and rich truths. Beware of complacency about our understanding of the book. The old Puritan saying, God has still fresh light to break forth from His holy word, is still true. There's that famous Martin Lloyd-Jones quote about the Holy Spirit and do we have it all at conversion? Have it all, have it all. When, where is it, pray? Why are you as you are? Same applies to the scriptures. Understand it all, know it all, let alone live it all, then why are you as you are? Pray. Continue to let God surprise you through His Word. But the same pattern of stability and unpredictability comes through the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, I know you know, but let me remind you, the Holy Spirit is a permanent presence, not a fleeting visitor. The Holy Spirit came to stay the moment you believed in Jesus. If you didn't have the Spirit, you were none of His. And earlier in Ephesians, it says that, in whom you also, when you heard the word of truth from the beginning, when you heard the gospel of salvation and believed in Jesus, you were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit, the pledge of our inheritance. Nothing more stable than that. The permanent presence of God lives in you permanently because of Jesus and what He has done and the faith that you now have in Him. But this stable, permanently present Holy Spirit is gloriously unpredictable, is glorious, totally trustworthy, but gloriously unpredictable because He knows better than we do. And He reveals His purposes on what I call a needs-to-know basis. And most of the time, it seems, he doesn't think we need to know. remember a time when we were really seeking God about whether we should make a move, and we set aside some time on holiday and we said, Lord, we will keep seeking you until we know what you want us to do, till we hear you. And we heard him loud and clear. He said, you don't know yet because I've not yet told you. So we enjoyed our holiday. So because God is so much wiser than us and needs us to trust him, not only trust him when we know his plans, the Spirit will continually surprise us. That commentary I read on Ephesians said this, the filling by the Spirit is more than the Spirit's indwelling. It is his activities realized in and through us. With the indwelling, each Christian has all of the Spirit. But with the command to be filled with the Spirit, it enables the Spirit to have all the believer. Now, I know that's often taught in terms of surrender. You know, you've got all the Spirit as the Spirit got all of you. And that's a good challenge. But I don't think that's what this is about. This is not about surrender. This is about availability. This is continually be open to the initiatives of the Spirit filling you because the Spirit has work for you to do. It's the grammar is keep on allowing yourself to be filled. Continually keep alert. Open to new insights from God's word. Continually alert to the initiatives of the Spirit. And sometimes because we've had good experiences or we're so assured of the presence of the Spirit, I think we assume upon the Spirit when we may be quenching or grieving the Spirit. Because we're not attentive. We're so rejoicing in the stability. We've lost a level of openness to that glorious unpredictability that is for the blessing of others. Don't allow the stability to make you complacent about word or about spirit. Let both teach you. Let both disturb you. I mean, for instance, the story of Peter and Cornelius, it comes three times it's accounted in Acts. The first time, Peter hesitantly obeys a call of the Holy Spirit to do something that seems to him to be against what he thinks he's learnt from Scripture. It's not, but that's what it feels like at the time. In the chapter 11, I quoted it in as at the beginning, he's back to the church back home, and he's worked out that it really was according to the word of the Lord. By the time they get to Acts 15 and the Jerusalem Council, they're reflecting on this huge breakthrough to reach the Gentiles, which in chapter 10, Peter isn't sure is of God. And by chapter 15, James is quoting the prophets to show why it was the fulfillment of Scripture. Do you see, the Spirit never tells you to disobey the word. But the Spirit will sometimes seriously upset your current interpretation about some things and lead you through a process at the end of which you will know Scripture better. And you see, the local church is meant to be a safe environment for unpredictable encounters with the Holy Spirit. Because there's the stability as the context for the unpredictability. I've got a final hanger for you. We are nearly done. Not many of you have the great privilege of living in beautiful North Yorkshire. As you don't, I need to take you. We're going to go to the village of Newton on Rawcliffe, and we're going to walk along a path, and we're going to look down in a valley at a place called Levisham. And we did that as a family, and we saw this beautiful valley, and then we saw steam. And then we heard a noise, because down in that valley is the North Yorkshire Moor Steam Railway. And this beautiful train came along. I took the picture. And then it stopped. And we thought, well, of course it stopped. It's a little station at Levisham. The people are getting on and off. But it waited, and it waited, and it waited. We couldn't understand why. And then we heard a whistle. And then we saw some steam. And then round the track from the other way came another train. Because next picture, Levisham is one of the few places where the trains can pass. Not the same engines, but there's two of them in Levisham station. And, well, I'm going to draw one or two things from that. First of all, did you note that the first train had to wait until the second train arrived? And according to the word, we wait for the Spirit's timing. But there's something more from this. The trains came from opposite directions. One came from Whitby, one came from Pickering. They meet here at Levisham. In a similar way, the Word and the Spirit come to us from opposite directions. We learn in this book we receive from the past. We honor it, we treasure it. Paul says, I received it as of first importance, and I passed on very carefully exactly what I received. Christ died according to the Scriptures. He was raised according to the Scriptures. You don't change it, you receive it, you guard it, you pass it on, and like Paul, you add your testimony to it. But the Spirit comes from the future. The Spirit is the first fruits here and now of the great final harvest at the end of the age. The Spirit is the down payment, the first installment of what Jesus promises to pay in full when he comes. The Spirit is the guarantee now of what will happen then. And the Spirit in Hebrews is called the taste of the powers of the age to come. The disciples in Acts 1 said, is it the kingdom now? And Jesus says, not the whole kingdom now. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. The Holy Spirit is a future in advance gift. When you are come to know Jesus and you are assured of salvation, you know in advance the decision on the last day. When there is a healing touch, you've had an advanced taste of the perfect health of the new heaven and the new earth. When we care for the poor in the name and the power of Jesus, we have an advanced taste of that day when in a new heaven and new earth there will be no poverty. When we stand against injustice in the power of the Spirit, it is an advanced taste of that day when there is a new heaven and new earth in which righteousness and justice are totally at home. The Spirit does not come to make the church relevant. The Spirit does not come to make the church contemporary, although we are empowered to embody Jesus in a way appropriate to our day. The Spirit comes to the church to make it prophetic, to make it a future in advance people who in their life and ministry show people a taste of the future Jesus has secured and is described about and is promised in his word, to give a taste in advance and minister that. It's a twin track. It's the way God's people move ahead into his future while remaining rooted in and governed by what he's done and revealed in the past. The Spirit promised in Scripture comes to the church in each generation to enable it to be that prophetic future in advance community. We've had our hangers. As at the beginning, that's the vital one, Pentecost was a beginning, not a one-off event. God's two hands, the menu and the meal, the marriage, what God has joined together, the common purpose in which the security and the unpredictability, and then the twin track, the gift from the past and the gift for the present. Brothers and sisters, stay rooted in God's word.